we will be seeing the theory of prism, which is a very important topic in optics. So theory of prism. Okay, so what is prism? Prism is just a combination of two triangles with a cylindrical shape connected to it. Okay. So like this, this is a front face, this is back face in a prism. Okay, so this is a general structure of prism. There are two faces, front and back, and these are the edge faces of that prism. Okay, so there are various types of questions which are asked from the prism section. So let's analyze when the light ray is incident on this prism, what will happen to that light ray. Okay, so suppose that this is the face of prism and this is the light ray which is incident. So this is called as incident ray. And this is called emergent ray. Okay, so the ray which is incident from on the prism, this is called the incident ray, and ray coming out from the prism is called the emergent ray. And the angle which the normal makes from the with the incident ray I1 is called the incident angle. Incident angle. And the normal making with the emergent ray is called the emergent angle. Okay, and the angle which is between emergent ray and the incident ray, this angle beta is called angle of prism. So angle of prism is the angle between incident ray and the emergent ray. Okay, so this is the angle of prism which is present between the two rays, angle of prism. So these are the some of the angles which we have to remember for moving further. So the incident ray, incident angle, emergent ray, emergent angle, and angle of prism. So beta is angle of deviation, which we write sometimes, but here I have denoted with beta, but beta is angle of deviation in some cases. Okay, so we can call it A, angle of prism A. Okay, so these three four things we have to remember for solving the questions. Okay, so moving further, let's see what happens when the light ray is incident. So this is a incident ray. This one is the emergent ray, as we saw. This is the angle of the prism. Okay, so when the incident ray is fallen on the face of the edge of the prism, then this is the normal. So what, and the when it goes inside it, so this is the first, R1 is the first angle of refraction which is with the normal and edge of the prism. First angle of refraction. Okay, and this angle which is making with the emergent ray and the normal is I2 or the emergent angle, and this R2 is second angle of refraction. And the beta, which when we extend this incident ray and the emergent ray, and we saw this angle. This angle is called beta. Suppose that this is the incident ray and this is the emergent ray. So this angle is called beta. Okay? Or the deviation angle. Deviation angle is nothing but it tells that how much is the ray, incident ray is bended after passing through the prism. So after passing through the prism, how much is the ray is bended or suffered the bending, how much it has suffered the bending. So it, if we calculate this beta angle, so it will automatically tell us that how much is the ray bended or how much is the ray deviated from its initial path. So if we want to calculate the how much ray is deviated from its initial path, we will directly calculate this deviation angle or the beta, which is the angle between emergent ray and the incident ray. If we extend these two rays, we will be easily getting this beta. Okay, so beta is nothing but equal to I1 minus R1 plus I2 minus R2. We can directly simply see this is beta is this is I1 minus R1, this is I1. So opposite angles are equal. So suppose that this is I1, this is I1, so this is I1, but this is R1, so this is I1 minus R1, so this is I1 minus R1. So I1 minus R1, same thing like this. This is whole is I2, but this is R2. So this is I2 minus R2. So beta is I1 minus R1 plus I2 minus R2. Okay. So beta is I1 minus R1 plus I2 minus R2. How? This I1 and I1 are equal, but this is R1. So this is I1 minus R1. This I2 and I2 equal, but this is R2. So this is I2 minus R2. This is beta. So beta is nothing but equal to internal opposite. Sum of opposite angles of this triangle, so which is I1 minus R1 plus I2 minus R2. So beta is equal to I1 minus R1 plus I2 minus R2. Okay, so we can calculate this deviation angle beta like this. Okay, so these all the this point, let's say x, y, z, w, will form a cyclic quadrilateral. These four points will always form a cyclic quadrilateral. Okay. This was the prism. So this was I1, this was I2. So and here it was mu1 and here the refractive index was mu2. This was R1 and this was R2. Okay. So mu1 sine I1 is equal to mu2 sine R1. Okay. Or mu. So suppose that this is mu3 sine R1. Or mu3 sin R1, R2 is equal to mu2 sin I2. So these are the two equations which we get after applying Snell's law in prism. Okay, so this is the incident angle, and when it goes inside, this will be forming R1, and this is R2, and this is I2. So if it is showing grazing emergence, so we can suppose that this is 90, so we can directly apply from this to this. So mu1 sin I1 This is the incident angle, and this ray is showing gradient emergence or forming this 90 degree angle. So mu 2 directly this refractive index mu 2 sine 90 degree. So we can directly apply Snell's law from here to here. No need to write from here to here, then here to here. We can directly apply here to here. This is the advantage of the Snell's law. We can directly write between two faces, not necessarily which are present opposite to each other, but if they are far from each other also and they are connected, we can directly apply from first face to the third face. This is was first, this was second, and this was third. So we have directly applied from first to third. Mu1 sin I1 is equal to mu2 sin I2 when the ray is showing grazing emergence property. This is grazing emergence. So we have firstly in the TIR section we have total internal reflection lecture. We have saw this I1 is nothing else but critical angle of theta c. So mu1 sin theta c is equal to mu2 sin 90. So if the angle is, if the ray is incident at the critical angle, then it will show grazing emergence from the second surface of the prism. If the ray, first ray which is incident at the this angle theta c, then it will show grazing emergence property from the second surface. Okay, so these are the two equations which we can see or which we can remember. Mu1 sin I1 is equal to mu3 sin R1, mu3 sin R2 is equal to mu1 2 sin I2. This is the special case when it is showing grazing emergence property or the ray was incident at the critical angle at the first phase. Okay, and after that it will show up if the angle I1 is greater than this theta c, then it will show total internal reflection in the at this second surface. It will be directly coming inside only the prism. Okay, so if we want to shine that prism more, or like this only, if we want to make this diamond, suppose that this this is a diamond. So these things only happen in the diamond. What happens if the ray is incident but it don't go out from this surface of the diamond, from the second surface? It keeps on total internally reflecting from here only. So what happens, this theta is greater than theta c. If theta is greater than theta c, then the ray will come in and but don't go out from the second surface. This was a property when theta is equal to theta c, it will show grazing emergence. After that, it will just keep on total internally reflecting inside only, and it will not go out. So in diamond also, that's why diamond shines more. If the total internal reflection property we can somehow maintain more, so it will shine more. So like this only, it the ray will not go out. If it is a simple prism also, and if we incident the ray at an angle which is greater than theta c, it will not go out. It will just keep on totally internally reflecting inside the prism. Okay, thank you.